Yo, check dig. In this video, I sat down with Maria Mays, well-being coach and teacher of Take 5. We talk about the importance of breathing. We talk about anxiety, how to get back centered, the fastest way to get back centered. She even gave me an example of one of her techniques, so you want to make sure you stick to the end of this video. Welcome, Maria. How you doing? And welcome to That Christian in Recovery.
I'm doing great, Vernon. Thank you so much for having me.
Thanks. I'd just like to I'm a recovering addict, and I believe that everyone is recovering from something. So sometimes I just like to start to show off with what do you think that you're recovering from and that can help people out there? Doing your work, what do you think you're recovering from?
I would say, Vernon, I'm recovering from a fear-based lifestyle, from a lack of trust in myself, in my divinity. And so that's what I have focused now my life on, and stepping into my Dharma to help others take their power back from anxiety, to liberate themselves from fear. And that all starts with truly becoming in love with ourselves and the divinity within.
Okay. You said take your power back. Can you elaborate on that a little bit?
Sure. So I think, we come into this world beautifully aware of our divinity, right? Mm-hmm. And as we step into this world and the conditioning of the world and cultural expectations and societal expectations and parental expectations and all the stuff, right? Mm-hmm. There becomes more and more layers of continue to grow. Our truth continues to kind of dwindle. We kind of forget it. And so what I found is really to uncover that, it was a process of really tapping into some wisdoms and tools to help me take my power back. And by that, I mean, we all have a unique capacity to heal. I truly mm-hmm. believe that, just like we're all recovering from something, as you said, we all, I believe, have a unique capacity to heal. So it's finding that which works for us and uncovering our truth and starting with becoming really self-aware and becoming really self-compassionate. And when we have those two things, then we can become fully present. And to me, the most powerful tool to get us there, most powerful tool we have that's freely available, mm-hmm. no matter where we're at, who we are, is our breath. It can help us liberate ourselves from fear, from anxiety, from pain, from heartbreak, from all those things that we may be recovering from.
Okay, so you said breath. You talking about like our breathing?
Yes. So I teach breathing exercise as part of everything that I do. So I'm a well-being coach and teacher. And okay. What that means is, if, everybody's got their different definition of well-being. For me, my definition of well-being is joy. So when I'm in a state of joy, mm-hmm. my body is feeling vibrant, right? I'm not feeling anxiety and fear in the mind. I can't have those two things at the same time. I feel joyous and energized. And I'm not feeling lack then when I'm in a state of joy. And so whatever your definition is of well-being, mm-hmm. Typically it takes into the whole circle of being. And that is our mind, our physical body, right? This vessel that we're inhabiting right now, mm-hmm. as well as our spirit. So with that, I basically help people make transformations to step in their truth. And based on whatever they're looking for, right? But typically the most common outcomes I see within my clientele is a greater tool set and a greater understanding and deep belief in their divinity. So by tool set, I mean self-awareness and self-compassion. Those are skills. Right. So those don't happen overnight without a lot of practice and guidance. Cultivating those things takes some time. And so I'm just a little guide and a mentor to help folks find that place of inner peace. Because if you can get to a baseline of inner peace, which I truly think that's all we're all searching for, right?
Right.
If we can get to a baseline, then as the ups and downs of life happen, right, as the waves, the currents get really strong in life, that's not going anywhere. The stresses aren't going anywhere, Vernon. It's going to get more stressful probably, right? Mm-hmm. But our ability to flow with them, to float on top of them rather than to swim upstream, is really dependent on having that baseline of inner peace. And so that's what I help people get to either by coaching or teaching. So in both those cases, all of my offerings are centered in practices that involve the breath and that involve a lot of self-compassion, as well as learning how to love ourselves again.
Yeah. You was talking about that. I know she said well-being, whatever their definition of well-being. Mm-hmm. I noticed that you don't seem like you try to come in and throw what your definition is on them. You know, when you work with your clients, I'm hearing you right that you're saying whatever their definition of well-being. What are some of the things that you have found out, you know, helping people that's blocking them from reaching that inner peace?
You know, I think a lot of people get caught up in cycles of trying to meet expectations of others. And I found myself in that too. So for many a year, I tried to outrun my anxiety. And so for me, that involved self-medicating my anxiety with alcohol. Okay. And so it's one of those things that I think whatever, you know, if we look at any of these different things that we might be recovering from, right? Mm-hmm. Whatever that thing is, that substance or that activity, whatever it might be, there's a desire to, we get caught in these cycles, right? And so I'll just take you through a little example using some Sanskrit, if you will. So the teachings that I offer are based in Ayurveda, which is a very old holistic way of looking at life. And so it's a consciousness-based approach to life, to health. So basically we are more than just, you know, this physical rack of bones here. We are the mind that is within as well as the spirit. And so it's a holistic approach to health, focusing all on all those three components and not just the absence of disease, but truly living in vibrancy and all those pieces of well-being. And so part of what the teachings are there is you've probably heard the word karma before, right? It's a pretty common term. That's actually a Sanskrit word that translates to action.
Okay.
And what happens is a lot of us get caught up into a unconscious habit cycle, right? Mm. Just, we get caught up into just going through the motions, becoming on autopilot and not being truly present for whatever it is we're consuming or for whoever it is we are with. And so I found myself in that cycle. So for me, I'll just give you an example that I use sometimes in my teachings. So Sanskrit term karma translates to action, right? So let's say in this case, an action that I used to take is I'd get home from a long day of work, stressed out, just get in the door, you know, maybe the kids are coming at me, the house is crazy, you know, all the chaos, right? Mm-hmm. On autopilot, you know, hug the kids and then immediately walk over to the wine fridge and pour myself a glass of wine, not even having any conscious awareness of the fact that I was doing that because it became a habit. So the way those habits are formed is that action was me going and pouring myself a glass of wine, right? And drinking it. Right. And then what that created was a memory in me or a desire, right? So a memory that took the edge off. I'm feeling a little bit more calm now. I'm not thinking about that nasty gram email that I got from my boss. Right. I'm chilling out. Now I'm like, okay, well, let me figure out what we're going to make for dinner type thing. So it takes the edge off. It numbed a little of the pain that I was feeling. Mm-hmm. So that created a memory, right? And that memory then was lodged in my brain, where then the next time I came home, hey, there's that desire.
Yeah.
Right. I can just go to the wine fridge, pour a glass of wine, and next thing you know, I took the edge off. And so that first few times we might step into behavior right that, we don't realize that a little habit loop is forming. But the the way the brain works, and very interesting. I was just reading, what's the name of the book? Atomic Habits.
I knew that was coming. I did.
Yeah. And I read like, it. Oh,
I'm sitting there right? like, okay, I know.
Yeah.
I know
so
this book.
Similar.
Yeah.
It's
I love
such
it.
a parallel to what we teach within the law of karma here is also this habit loop that gets formed where our brains, our bodies are so magnificent in that they want to take the easy way out. Because if we can form these habits that are just autopilot, then we're ready for things that we might really need to do, like run from danger.
Yeah.
But the thing is, the danger today is often an email, not a tiger. Yeah.
Right.
So, so by becoming aware that we can fall into these habits, that's kind of the first step is just awareness, right? And then it's like, okay, how do I step out of that and become more conscious with my consumption? And what is my intention?
Okay.
Right? What is my intention behind the sip?
What's that's the part motive? Of what, okay.
Yeah. What is my intention? So I think that there's a lot of people at your health and at your well-being. And eventually, they can become really big issues in your life, or they can just slowly over time gradually deteriorate your health. So I think with a lot of clients that I see, I think there's some similarities in that there's a unprocessed maybe emotions, unprocessed traumas, things that we went through as we were younger maybe and didn't fully understand how to process because we weren't taught that. I mean, most of us in the age bracket, that I'm in and that most of my clients are in, it's just our parents did the best they could with what they had. And they didn't know about some of this neuroscience stuff and some of this, early childhood development stuff that we do now. So I feel like we have an obligation and a responsibility now, this generation, as we have this knowledge.
Yeah.
And science is validating all these old ancient wisdom teachings that, I practice and share. The modern science is validating all of this. And so if we have this information, then we're charged with using it, right, to better the world, right, to be better for our kids, to be better for the planet. So I think a lot of us just fall into that. It was nothing, there wasn't any motive, to step into that. It was just, you try something, you get a resulting desire to try it again, and then you fall into these unconscious habit loops. And that can be as simple as another book that kind of parallels this is Unwinding Anxiety, where he talks about the worry loop, right?
Yeah,
so very similar. So it's just becoming kind of aware at the start of it, having a desire, right, to maybe make some change in your life, but also becoming aware that we are unconscious. So the first part of becoming conscious, in order to get there, we have to be aware that we are unconscious, right?
Right. Again, I'm in a 12-step program, and our 12-step talk about that. It reads, after having a spiritual awakening as a result of these steps, right? After having a spiritual awakening, really what's taking place as we go through the steps, we're becoming conscious. Okay, and basically we have a working guide, and it asks us questions, right? Mm-hmm. How do you make your clients, how you help them become aware, conscious of their patterns?
So we start by really looking into how we are physically feeling in the body. And so a lot of us become really disconnected from the sensations in the body and really knowing even where we're at. We just have this, desire to change, or we come in with a, needing help, but not sure exactly why. And so, and I have worked with people, some of my clients have been in the 12-step program before working with me, and I haven't been in it personally, but I would say that I'm one of the many that's in that gray area that we maybe don't talk about that much. Maybe we didn't have an addiction to the point where we chose to seek out inpatient treatment or chose to go through a 12-step recovery program, but we became subject to self-medicating, with a substance. And so, and it's So I think there's a lot of people in that gray area where it's an unconscious self-medicating, and mm-hmm. it all goes back to something, right? It goes back to a lack of self-love. I think at the end of the day, that's what it all comes back to, a lack of self-love and a lack of trust. So we can, you know, I know you have an audience that's mostly Christian, and, you know, we can look at scriptures and we can read them and we can recite them. But if we don't have trust, deep knowing trust in God that we are divine and that we have that divinity inside of us, then no matter how many times I recite a scripture, if I don't have that trust or that self-love, then I'm really not going to become conscious and I'm really not going to have well-being.
You're right. You just be putting stuff on top of it. I mean, I was sharing with the pastor, you know, how you like you said, that loop. I can put drink and drugs on top of it. People in church can put, you know, scriptures on top of it. They can put, you know, singing songs and church activities, but never get to that core of self-love. I believe everything you're saying too, that self-love, that's where it all starts from. And, you know, and then when I do the work, the inner work that you talk about, I'm finding out that it goes way back to when I was a child.
Yeah.
Go way back to when I was a child. And I like how you said, you know, we have more information now, you know, and, you know, like our parents, then they weren't aware of the information that we have. And it's our obligation to give back. I really like that.
So I think, I don't know that I fully answered the question, but we start with kind of tapping into where they're at today, right? Where they're in that mind, body, spirit connection. Because a lot of times, if we have been self-medicating for a long time, or if we have been operating on autopilot in this disconnected state, there's a detachment between the mind and the body and the spirit. Okay. So there's an inability to even really understand and sense the felt emotion, what we would call qualia or a felt sense. Okay. And so I use a lot of somatics as we're first starting out to just drop into the body. And a lot of guided meditations. And so I have this, so my business, as you know, it's called Take Five. And it's called that for a number of reasons. When I was first, when I was stepping out of a period of my life where I had experienced what the world would call a nervous breakdown, I'm going to call it a spiritual breakthrough, right? I hit a wall, hit rock bottom, whatever you want to call it. Mm-hmm. And as I was climbing back out of that, I couldn't fathom taking an hour or a half an hour even of time for just me. I had been so busy caretaking for others, which is another habit people get into. You know, the martyr that's caretaking for everybody else but themselves. And then what happens? You can only do that so long until you hit a wall, right? And I did. Mind, body, spirit. So when I was coming out of that, I started with just, okay, I can take 5 minutes. I can take five a day. Okay. And if you don't have 5 minutes, take five breaths, right? Just if we slow the breath down and drop into a more conscious breath and just feel the body being breathed, that itself can help take us out of unconsciousness.
Yeah.
It's the fastest way to get present is through the breath. And so,
So
with Take Five, one of the things I offer is these 5 minute stretch and breath breaks just to help us step out of the noise of the day to take 5 minutes to connect with our truth, with ourselves, by grounding, by breathing, and just getting back to that mind, body, spirit connection. So that's kind of an integral part of my teaching too. And just self-compassion. I mean, we're so damn hard on each other and on ourselves, right? So I don't think we can truly have deep compassion for others if we don't have deep compassion for ourselves.
Right. Well, can you give us an example of that Take Five?
Yeah, let's do one. You want to do it right now?
Yeah, I want to do one.
Let's do it. All right. So let's start. Take a sip of water here. So I'll start by just asking you to notice how you're feeling in this moment. And then if you happen to be listening to this driving, keep your eyes open, please. But if you're not driving or not doing anything that's, you know, you need to have your eyes open for, or if you're, some cases we're not in a space where we feel comfortable or safe closing our eyes. So honor that. But if you can't close your eyes, then I ask you to just yawn. So if we take a yawn together, what it's going to do, it's going to naturally just put us in a little bit more of a relaxed state. The eyes soften a little bit. So it's like you're trying to keep them open, but they're just a little bit softer. Mm-hmm. And then I want you to bring your awareness to whatever part of your body is touching the floor. So again, if you're in a car, it would be the floorboard and the wheels would be making contact with the pavement. But if you're in a chair, like Vernon and I are, just feel the feet on the floor. And just for a moment, if you could imagine underneath that floor, or that pavement, there's some additional, maybe concrete, maybe a foundation. And underneath that, there's a topsoil. And then further underneath that soil, maybe it's less moist, maybe it starts to get a little denser. And if you could just imagine traveling down further into this earth that we're on, just reaching down into the bedrock, even that dense, thick bedrock. Just for a moment, allow that energy to come up through that bedrock, through all the different layers of soil, and allow it to recharge you. Feel it in your feet. Feel it through your legs to your knees, and allow it to rise up to your hips. And I want you to bring your awareness now to your seat and that space in between your hips and the low back, the tailbone. And I wonder if you could just get a little bit longer there from your tailbone to about your navel, just stretching out just on the low back, just a little bit more space in between each of those vertebrae. Just notice how that feels. And then from about your belly button to the center of the chest, can you elongate there? So we're creating space in that whole spinal column. As you get longer there, notice the shoulders can soften a little bit onto the back. And then from about the center of the chest to the crown of the head, can you get longer in that area? So that cervical spine, that little neck, all those tiny little neck muscles that hold up this head that's often tilted over looking at screens, let's just give it length, give it room to expand and grow, almost as if someone was gently pulling you up by your skull. So just notice how it feels to be so upright in this moment. Feet connected to the floor, feeling the energy of the earth coming in and grounding us. And heads just being pulled up a little bit more towards the heaven. And I want you to just bring your awareness to your breath now. Just noticing it. And just notice if there's any part of your body where you're holding tension, constriction. I just want you to send your breath there in this moment. So for a lot of us, it's in the neck and shoulders. So if you'd like to join me in inhaling the shoulders up towards the ears. And as you exhale, releasing the shoulders back down. Just taking a few more breaths like that together. Inhaling, maybe drawing the shoulders up towards the ears again, if that feels good. And as you exhale, just releasing worry. Just for now, just release the worry. And as you take another inhale, just feel all that oxygen come in and rejuvenate all the cells. And as you exhale, just for now, release the doubt, release the fear, release the worry. Now I just want you to not worry so much about breathing, but just allow the body to be breathed. Just allow the body to be breathed, and just give permission for every cell in the body to receive the breath. Give permission to every muscle, every tissue, every bone, just receive that breath. Maybe now even giving permission to every emotion that might be coming up, that's existing, every thought. Give those thoughts and feelings and emotions permission to just receive that breath. And just noticing now. We continue to rest just for a moment or two here, just noticing how you're feeling in the body, just resting and being breathed, resting in your wholeness, resting in your enoughness, resting in your divinity. When you're ready, just slowly starting to open the eyes and bring the sensation back to the body. And then just noticing how you feel now compared to how we started.
Oh man, I'm ready to go to sleep. Feel like a deep massage. That's what it feels like. Where am I?
That's good. Yeah. Well, sometimes we can't get a deep massage, right? So, but we can take that 5 minutes to just reconnect. And so that's really my message, is that we have more power than we think, right? And so we can take back our power by just coming back to our truth, by stepping away from all the noise, all the to-dos, all the expectations. So we just need to have that time in our day to not have to perform, to not have to achieve, to not have to do anything, just to be in our body.
Yeah. I remember years ago, I worked for corporate America. And, you know, so when I first was working, I was stressed. It was, you know, corporate America, you never worked at corporate America. It's a different society. So another guy, I went to a guy house that had been working for this company for years. And that's what he had me do. I was stressed. I was like, I don't know if I'm going to make it here. It was Procter & Gamble. I was like, I don't know if I can make it here. It's, you know, then he said, just, I'm going to teach you something. And he did that. But he had me breathing like 7 seconds. Then I had to hold it like 7 seconds. Then I had to slowly release it out my nose. And I did that about 3 times. And it was gone. He said, so I know that breathing is very, you know, very energizing. And I like how you talk about how we have the power just by connecting with ourselves. What about you? What about nature? You think nature has a role in that?
Are you kidding me? Nature is our power. I literally just wrote, I have a Wednesday well-being newsletter that goes out to my subscribers. And the one that went out to just today was about, you know, the healing power of nature, right? In terms of, you know, if your listeners just think in this moment, what makes you feel most fully alive, most fully you, right? Just what's that thing? For me, it's exploring in nature. And that's a huge part of what Ayurveda teaches, which is just really getting back into the rhythms of nature. So we've over time come so much away from nature because we spend our days mostly in, you know, in offices or indoors, right? We eat a lot of foods that aren't fresh from nature. They're processed and manufactured, right? And if we look at all these things that take nature out of the equation, that's where when really things that start to manifest in the body and then start to evolve into disease start to happen. And so the healing power of nature is unmatched, with the exception of the breath, because the breath you can do anywhere. You can do it inside, you can do it outside, but pairing those two together is even more amazing. So I do, in fact, my meditation this morning, I did outside because it was warm enough to do it. So outside, if I can, I meditate outside. So that's part of what I teach. I teach meditation and breath work and incorporate that into all my coachings too. And so that 777 breath that you mentioned, there's a lot of breathing exercises that are designed as rescue breaths, where if I'm in a moment that's a panic, for example, I will actually use that breath to take me out of a state of panic. Let's say there's one called the 478 breath, same thing. So there's several different exercises that you can do to take you from a high anxiety, panic, stress state into a more calm state. And then there's some breathing exercises that are designed to, when you're really depressed and feeling low and just don't have the energy, need to exercise, don't want to, you know, you're having that back and forth, you can do some breaths that energize. And there's some that do both. And so in some cases, we can take some breathing exercises that allow us to, so the she breath is one of those where it energizes and relaxes. And with those, it creates mental clarity and focus to where then we're not, you know, overwhelmed with the to-do, the quota, the meeting, the board, whatever it is that we have to perform for, right? Mm-hmm. We can just tap into that power within and say, okay, I'm here in this body with my breath. Let me just move on now with more clarity.
Yeah. Yeah. And you can do the, do you recommend that we do these breathing exercises throughout the day?
Yeah, I recommend that you you try to incorporate at least 5 days of breath work into your day, right? And so that's part of why I developed this Take Five, just to encourage people just to do that. What happens is if you can do 5 minutes a day, regular, even a coherent breath. So a coherent breath is a 5 second inhale, and a 5 second exhale. Or maybe it's a 4-4-6-6. Coherent meaning that the inhale and the exhale are going to be the same, but we slow it down. So if you can do that, for example, there's data showing that if you do that daily for about 6 weeks, you actually rewire your nervous system. And so that's when then we can drop into them when we need them. So the reason I can very quickly drop into a breathing exercise when I'm feeling stressed, like my kids will see it. They'll be like, uh-oh, what's going on, mom? You're doing your breathing again. Are you stressed out? Or, you know, what's going on?
Right.
It's because I've rewired my brain through practice. And all these things are practices, right? Self-compassion, self-love, positive, you know, positive thoughts, you know, rewiring all that stuff. This stuff doesn't happen without work. We got to do the work, Vernon. So practice, practice makes progress, right?
The meditation, a lot of people, matter of fact, me and my nephew, he's my personal trainer. We were talking about it this morning about meditating. He said he just started.
Oh, good for him.
And I was sharing with him because I've been doing it for like a couple of months off and on, right? You know, trying to, you know, implement it to my daily activity. But the benefits that I've been getting from it mostly it is the calmness, but I'm learning how just thoughts just run through my mind. And, you know, and what I've learned is that I don't have to grab them. I can just let them go through. So during the day, if I'm sitting with my wife or I'm sitting with the kids, if I get a thought, I don't have to believe it. I can just sit there and let it go. What are some of the benefits that
isn't that amazing?
How powerful is that, Vernon, that you've taken
your power back right there just by saying, I don't have to jump on and grab that thought.
Right. Awesome, mate. But I love it. But what's some of the benefits that you
So the benefits of meditation are long. And so for me personally, I'll tell you that, you know, my story is from self-medicating to meditating. That is truly what changed my life. Using my breath to meditate. I also do a mantra-based practice, which is I teach a primordial sound meditation. And then I also practice loving kindness meditation, as well as the equanimity meditation. And so the benefits just overall, lowering our stress level, right? Increasing our resiliency, meaning that as the stresses come throughout the day, we're less reactive, right? So we can either react to a stimulus or we can have a mindful response to it. Okay. And a lot of us, especially those that were in that hamster wheel of productivity and maybe trying to outrun our anxiety through either productivity or self-medicating with alcohol or whatever it is. Just speaking for myself, I'm sure nobody else on listening is like that, but it can help us step off that hamster wheel, right? So lowering our blood pressure, and some of the amazing things, it can shorten our or decrease the shortening of the telomerase gene and maybe even make it longer in new studies. So said a more simplified way, we have so much more power than we give our credit ourselves credit for. So if you think, okay, I got heart disease in my family, I got Alzheimer's in my family, I got this, I got that, only 5% of genes are fully penetrant, meaning they directly cause disease. 95% of it is lifestyle. So if you're telling me I have a 95% chance, if I cultivate a lifestyle for my children, 95% of it is in my control.
Wow.
That's a lot of power. And we're not realizing that because the world isn't telling us that, but the data is showing us that. So by reducing stress through having a meditation practice, we can also reduce our blood pressure. And then all those different things that are associated with high stress, we can reduce the speed at which we age, actually. That has to do with that that gene I was mentioning. And so I just think, you know, if we make, as humans, we make things so difficult. And it's really so simple, right? If we just get back to the basics in terms of connecting with nature, coming back to things which truly make us feel alive, coming back to foods that come directly from nature, right?
Yeah.
And spending more time in it, just that alone can have such an impact on our emotions and on our physical health, as well as our mental health, and so, and our spiritual health.
Yeah, totally awesome. It's been a pleasure. But I got before we wrap this up, I got to ask you one more question. Okay, we do all these things. We meditate. We go with nature. We change, you know, the diet, whatever. Okay, what prevents people from going back to the things that started the anxiety in the first place? How do you handle those type of things?
I think the key there is finding what is the unique capacity of that individual. So we each have a different, what we refer to as a mind-body constitution. So a different combination of the elements in us. And what makes me happy, brings me joy, relaxes me, is going to be different than you. I mean, there's going to be some common similarities throughout all of this, right? But I think the thing is, we have to take a very personalized approach and find what brings you joy. And that is within food, within movement, moving anxiety through the body. So a lot of times these emotions and stuff, they're just trapped, they're stagnant, they're constricted, and they're not meant to be. They're meant to alert us to maybe some dysfunction or make us aware of stuff. You know, pain is kind of a
sending
us messages, a guide, and then move it through the body. So I would say the number one way to not go back to old habits is finding something that you truly lights you up. And we all have that. It's just a process of uncovering that and remembering that. And when we find that, then we're going to crave it. I mean, every morning when I wake up, I crave my meditation because I found that that works for me. But another person might crave getting up and running. Well, that's not me, but
I got you. Yeah. Okay. I like that.
Yeah, it's really just dependent on helping that individual tap into the wisdom within.